Hello and welcome to Curator with a Camera. I'm Anthony Cools, Senior Curator of Rail Transport and Technology at the National Railway Museum, and today we're at Locomotion in Shildon to have a look at this, the Advanced Passenger Train, APT. In the 1960s, British Railways were heading towards a 100-mile-an-hour railway. On the East Coast Main Line, the Deltics were running regularly at 100 mile an hour on express passenger services. On the West Coast Main Line, south of Crewe down to London, new electric locomotives were doing the same, running at 100 miles an hour regularly on express trains. But north of Crewe, the West Coast Main Line curves, and the trains at their certain speeds would begin to hunt, which is like a side-to-side movement, which is very uncomfortable for the passengers. It's quite unnerving, and it could lead to derailments. So British Railways wondered what to do, and they found their solution with a man called Alan Wickens. In 1962, British Railways engaged Alan Wickens from the aerospace industry to undertake research into the rail-wheel interface and how they could control the side-to-side movement, the hunting, which was causing such problems. And after extensive research throughout the 1960s and prototyping and computer modelling, the ultimate fruit of Wickens and his team's research was this, the Advanced Passenger Train Experimental, APT-E. So let's have a look at it. You've got something that's quite unlike anything else the railways have seen. This is prior to the high-speed train and Kenneth Grange and his no couplings and buffers on the front end. But this is purely an experiment. It doesn't need to be coupled to anything because British Railways use abandoned section of 13 miles of railway in Leicestershire near a place called Old Dolby for their test track, which is solely used to try this train out. It's like something out of a very futuristic film. There's nothing on it, there's no external door handles, there's no fiddly details. This train, every inch of it, is made to run fast and cut through the air. The aerodynamics of this, you know, reflect that aerospace industry origins. So there's the grills on the side to allow as much air in to cool the gas turbines as possible, and then the exhaust stacks on the top, these very large cowlings, because there are four British Leyland gas turbines providing power to each power car, and then a fifth turbine at the end there to provide auxiliary power for electric and air and the various research systems in there. It's an unusual colour scheme, very different to the British Railways blue and grey, because that is the BR blue there, but this is not grey as such, it's actually a metallic sort of silver. So it's beyond the British Railways corporate image. One of the key innovations of the advanced passenger train was this ability to tilt, the ability to go into curves at speed and tilt the cars over so that they were able to transition smoothly rather than jolt and make it a rough ride. And here we are, warning, tilt system active, keep away. It's because it was able to be tilted whilst it was stationary as well as moving, so you didn't want to have people in the way as they were doing it. And there's tilt mechanisms underneath here. You can see, because we've moved this a few times, the hydraulics have been disabled, but there's a longitudinal beam there which helps the transfer of the motion between the bogey and the bodies, which is again very key to how this thing operates. And there's some of the piping coming down from the tilt pack in PC2 as to how it all happens. Then there's more cabling for the electric motors on the outside. And actually, yes, while we're talking about electric motors, those are the motors around the axle. That's how this thing works. It's not got a separate motor. It's the motor is integral part of the mechanism there. So having had a look at the outside of this amazing train, let's go and find out a little bit more about what it's like inside and have a look at the driver's cab. So one of the incredible things that I really like about this is that how do you get into this train? Because you've got that amazing aerodynamic shape on the outside. And here is our little secret steps. in that, having opened the door, we can then push this button and the access steps drop out like that. It's fantastic, isn't it? But there we are, steps open. Let's go and see inside. It's here in this seat that records were broken and new records set. It's here that the engine, that the unit becomes the fastest train to go from London to Leicester. It does it in less than 60 minutes, which is an average speed of over 100 miles an hour. And it's here that APT-E hits 152.3 miles an hour on the 10th of August 1975. Absolutely amazing place to be, and assuring the APT-E of its place in history. But what have we got in here? Something that looks more like it's out of the flight deck of an aircraft, perhaps. Again, going to that APT lineage, back to the work of Alan Wickens, but also English Electric. So the window here, the front windscreen, it's really quite small, and everything's very, very high tech. But actually, in terms of physical controls, you've got very few. You've got directions, forward shunt and forward main, so shunting at slow speed for the direction. You've got a brake here, and then on this side you've got power. You can hear the notches as it goes through, and then a horn switch there. The rest of all of this material is to inform the driver what's happening with this testbed on wheels. So here are indication switches to do with the turbine, demist for the windscreen, controls on, but there's a lot of stuff about faults. There's a lot of check brake, remote trailer car fire. This is a gas turbine unit as well, so there's a lot of concern about safety, and there's whole things about whether there are fires. There's wheel slip here, heat detector reset, reducing speed. There's our ammeter for what the alternator is producing off the generator, speedo there, inches of mercury for the vacuum, and this here is the automatic warning system, the signalling system, sunflower, which has the yellow, and that's why it says suspected tritium paint there, because when the sunflower is showing and you get the yellow triangles in that, that will be that paint will be reflective and radioactive. But more of these lights here, steps up, steps down, cab heater, and further more indication panels here, lights of what's happening, bearing lubrication, auxiliary power unit under voltage, train airline low pressure, passenger emergency, and different bits here, oil level fault in the tilt, blocked oil filter in the tilt. Lots of things telling the crew in the cab what's happening. But also the telephone there that's linked through to the man in TC2 who's monitoring what the generators are up to, the power units. So there's these are mirrors of the instrumentation that's in TC2 showing what's happening with the power. And then for shunting, you've got a very simple power and brake control, because when you're shunting this thing, again, the direction there, you can't see very much of what's happening on the floor. Rather than driving it sitting down like this, you want to be able to drive it with the side window open, so we're not looking at speed. That window drops down, and you can drive it from the side using that control whilst you've got a really good line of sight to see the shunter on the ground. And that's about it. There's would have been a lot more happening, obviously, with it on the go. A lot of these lights lighting up, and sounds, and the adrenaline, because you're in here with a traction inspector, you're in here with an engineer, at least one riding engineer, and probably some of the APT development team who are interested in what it's actually doing. But the atmosphere, we have one recording of when it took the record, the 152.3 miles an hour, and it's absolutely amazing. It's live action of what was happening, and you can hear them describing the speed getting faster and faster.
150 dead.
Hallelujah.
151.
51.
52. 152.3. It's my human as what a sweet. Oh,
wow. And into the hidden world of Trailer Car 2, TC2. What have we got here? Oh, look, there we go. Toilet. Vacant, nobody's in. That's not exactly where it... The most exciting part of the train, but there we are. Genuine 1970s BR soap. I think we probably need to accession that. Always good to know you have the facilities on board. But we walk through the train, through the car, and there's some of that beautiful, glorious 1970s BR orange maquette. A little compartment here for relaxation, perhaps, a bit of downtime from the high octane stress that goes on in here. Because, very much in the words of Hamilton, this is the room where it happens. And this is Trailer Car 2, TC2, packed full of gadgetry, equipment, and monitoring systems. So, we see here the tilt control unit, which is quite small there. The HK brake control unit, that's a hydrokinetic braking system to slow the train down from those incredibly high speeds. In fact, there is a picture of the train leaving St Pancras on one of the high-speed trials that they did between London and Leicester, where it made Leicester in less than an hour, which was incredible. The big box underneath us, underneath there, is the tilt pack itself. It says it's soundproof because the noise from the hydraulic pump and the control systems would be too much otherwise. It's inside the vehicle here because the team need easy access to adjust it and modify it during the testing. So they can actually tweak this thing on the move. The prototype train's APT-P. This was mounted beneath the carriage itself. So moving from the tilt pack and all the gizmos and gubbins there, we have something almost straight out of sci-fi here. If it looks a little Doctor Who, well again, it's a child of the 70s. This is all the technical instrumentation which is recording what's going on. So throughout the test runs, there are guys sitting here with headsets on, mic'd up, watching what's happening, flicking switches, checking recording systems. Really everybody concentrating in this train, and really quite exciting runs when you look into what this train was up to. They were pushing boundaries every time they went out. This is where the high speed is being recorded, but of course this isn't just about the speed of the train, it's about the performance of the rails and the wheels and the turbines, how it's operating. Every movement is monitored. You can see that each of these has plugs, switches, people are moving the wires around to suit what's happening where and when. So they are lab coach lines number one end, lab coach lines number two end, TC1, PC1, bogey input lines. This is all pre-digital. This is all wires and relays. It's an amazing thing. And actually, testimony to the APT-E support group who help us look after this, because a lot of this material had been stripped out when the train came into the museum. It was pretty much a carcass. And between APT support group and the National Computing Museum and a couple of other supporters, including Serco Rail in Derby, where the train was constructed and tested initially, they've helped us put all this lot back, which is absolutely amazing. If it sounds like I don't know what any of it does, that's because I don't. But this is the nerve centre of why and how APT is and what it does and how it performs. This was never intended to be a passenger carrying train. This is solely an experimental device, an experimental vehicle. You can see the lightweight fibre panels there, but also there very clearly the structural members of the carriage. So it's said that having been made alongside the F6 Lightning, there are some common components. Now, I'm not entirely sure I'd like to blast an APT into space or put a Lightning aircraft along the East Coast Main Line. But nonetheless, the common materials, the common style of manufacture is there. two final pieces up here, the all important clock to see what time it is and where you are. Smith's, very well known manufacturer of clocks there. But then the speedometer as well, very large numbers, 300 kilometers an hour up to, which of course translates roughly at quite a lot of miles an hour. So down the far end of the train from all that instrumentation is a very basic box here, which is the tilt control and monitor. And so this controls and monitors exactly what's happening with each bogey under each power car and trailer car. So they've got the power and the control and what's happening, whether there's low pressure or a burst hose to reset. Quite what lane change means, I'm not sure. Blue, add that in the comments if you have an understanding of what it is. And yeah, fire in the tilt pack. I really rather hope that never came to pass. Well, I don't think it ever did, but always good to know that you've got the ability to find out. And there on the bench, on the table in front of it, are the two air horns, which gave the APT-E the distinctive sound, the warning sound when it was on the track, because of course, at upwards of 140 to 150 miles an hour, you've got very little warning that this thing's going to there until it's upon you. So to have a really good audible warning system is very, very important. So what happened with the APT project? Well, once APT-E had fulfilled all of its trial purposes of running at speed and running comfortably and running well, once it had set those records, the APT-P prototype production program was already underway. So there was no need for four cars of mobile testbed again. And by November 1976, APT-E was part of the National Collection and parked up at the National Railway Museum. But what of its place in history? It could be argued that all you need to know about the development of Britain's railway engineering can be summed up in three names. Richard Trevithick, who created the steam locomotive, Stevenson father and son, who create railway networks operated by locomotives from the outset, and Professor Alan Wickens, who gave us the APT and the ability to run trains every day at over 100 miles an hour. I hope you've enjoyed our look at the advanced passenger train today. Perhaps you might say it's the long lost cousin of the high speed train, which also features in one of our Curator with a Camera series. But if you have enjoyed it today, why not like and subscribe so that you don't miss out on future episodes.